Con ustedes, Sara Hawk, directora del Festival Internacional de Cine de Guanajuato.
Buenas tardes. Bienvenido a esta conferencia de Steven Goldblatt. Estamos muy emocionados de poder presentar esa conferencia magistral sobre la fotografía de este norteamericano que ha trascendido a nivel nacional, Estados Unidos como internacionalmente. Es una de las joyas que llega a vivir a San Miguel de Allende. Siempre nos sorprende San Miguel, quien está a nuestro alrededor. Y Steven, quiero contarles la historia porque sí es muy amena, es padre. Steven se fue un día a un restaurante en San Miguel, estaba sentado en la barra, pidió su comida, está platicando con el bartender y el señor le dice, ¿tú qué haces? Ah, pues soy fotógrafo. Ah, pues aquí en San Miguel hay muchos fotógrafos. Y dice, sí, pues soy fotógrafo de cine. Ah, ¿con quién has trabajado? No, oh, pues fulano. ¿Y conoces a Sara? Y dice, no, ¿quién es Sara? Ah, pues hay un festival de cine. Dice, pues te voy a dar mis datos y mátaselo. Y en el transcurso de 3 semanas, no sé dónde iba esta notita que apuntó su puño y letra, se viajó por las calles de San Miguel y me llegó a la oficina, ¿qué te gusta? 2 semanas antes del festival. Y nos dimos cuenta que el San Miguel de Allende está uno de los cinematógrafos más importantes de nuestros tiempos. Entonces, con ustedes, Steven Goldblatt.
Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon. Good
afternoon. So, Steven, it's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for making the time and for being so generous with your time this week. I want to ask you a little bit about your background before we start. Where were you born?
I was born in South Africa and moved to England when I was a child.
What prompted the move back to England?
Politics.
And
not my fault.
When did you first take an interest in photography?
About 11 years old.
And there was still photography at that time?
Yes. Well, I watched my father trying to load an 8mm camera. He couldn't do it, and I was just ashamed, so I took up.
And did you have some formal photography studies?
Well, I went to photography school, but I learned nothing. So. Except not to go to photography.
And then what was it, were among your first photography assignments, like professional photography assignments?
Well, the school was hired to be stringers for Harry Nash, for the funeral of Winston Churchill, and I was very young, and I managed to get 3 pages from Harry Nash, so I left the school. It seemed I fell into photography like a duck into water. You know, it just was natural to me. I could do nothing else. I couldn't count, and I was hopeless at painting and anything, but photography I could do as soon as I opened my eyes.
How old were you at the time?
At the Winston Churchill funeral, I was 18.
18 years old, and you dropped out of school, and you said, this is what I'm going to do.
And I got employed immediately.
It seems around your generation, it seems like a story that I've heard a few times.
Yeah, it was London. It's fabulous.
Why was it? Why were the conditions that way that people like you could just get a job at 18?
I can't explain.
No.
It was luck.
Super lucky. And can you tell us a little bit about, that was when you were 18, a few years later,
Well, the very brief story is I was still a photographer. I liked it. It was a lonely life. You're always fighting other photographers. And twice a week I had an assignment to go to the movie studios, Pinewood Studios, Shepperton Studios. And I just loved the atmosphere of the film crew. I felt at home there. I liked the way people collaborated. And I thought, I want to do this. And I literally sold my camera. And I went to film school so that I couldn't be, when I was broke, that I couldn't be tempted back into still photography.
Mm-hmm.
I was in 3 years of film school, and I began to shoot for fellow students, and I was the only person there who wanted to be a cinematographer. Okay. Everyone else wanted to direct.
Okay. And you were still doing still photography assignments here and there, right?
Here and there, but when I finished film school, nothing. I didn't do any still photography for maybe 20 years.
Okay. In 1968, you had a chance encounter, and you had a very interesting assignment. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, briefly, I worked for the Beatles for 3 months, and was lucky enough to get some famous pictures of them.
How did that come about?
Oh, so I can't even begin to tell. It is a great story. I've got a book on it.
Find the book somewhere.
But you should look at the movies.
Oh, very cool. Okay. So I just wanted to, before we go into this, just ask you a little bit about what you think about the role of the cinematographer is, because I think some people have a conception of what a cinematographer is, and I feel like you have a very...
Well, my conception, my work as a cinematographer is not as a technician. Yes, you've got to have a grasp of the technique. And in film, rather than digital, your grasp had to be pretty extensive, because digital allows you to fail and to fix. But film, there was no fixing. You either got it right or you got fired. And the cinematographers being fired is a common occurrence. It's never happened to me, but I've wanted it to. But no. Anyway, what is on the clips you're all going to see, and I hope you like them, the majority are film, shot on film, finished on film, or many of them shot on film, finished digitally. And what's happened with cinematography is that the role of the cinematographer has become less powerful. It used to be that we held all the power, but now often we share it with the visual effects supervisor, which is something I don't enjoy. So I'm not doing visual effects movies anymore, and I prefer to work on low budgets where I can keep the, as Vittorio Storaro calls it, the authorship of the image. And so if anybody wants me to shoot a really good low budget movie, I'm available. San Miguel, there you
No, you said you're very comfortable working with digital photography, correct?
Yes, it's easy. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's going from film to digital is easy.
Mm-hmm. You have no nostalgia, no love loss for working in film?
A little bit, but it's more of the political change on the film set that I regret.
Would you like to jump right into the clip?
Yeah, so the first clip we're going to look at is a short sequence out of Batman Forever, shot on film. Within the sequence, there are only two visual effects shots. The opening shot, in which you'll see the car, the back car, going down a long avenue, is actually shot real. The car is real, the avenue is real, it's Wall Street. And we had a crew of near 200 people to do the shot in New York at night. Okay.
Entonces podemos bajar luces y correr clip, por favor.
You're trying to get out of my cave, Doctor.
A girl can't live by psychoses alone.
The car, I just love the car.
What is it about the wrong kind of man? In grade school, it was the guys with earrings. College, motorcycles, leather jackets. Now, oh, black rubber.
Try and fire him. Let's take off.
I don't mind the work. Pity I can't see behind the mask.
We all wear masks.
My life's an open book. You read it?
I don't blend in at a family picnic.
Oh, we could give it a try. I'll bring the wine. You bring your skirt, Psyche.
Direct, aren't you?
You like strong women. I've done my homework. Or do I need skin tight? I'm one with.
I haven't had that much luck with women.
Maybe you just haven't met the right woman.
I saw the signal. What's going on?
Nothing. False alarm.
Are you sure?
So you can see that the lighting is has a definite style and intended and all on film. Challenging. A part of the role of the cinematographer is also to make his, particularly his female actors, look beautiful. And it was easy with this particular actor. And also, Val Kilmer, such beautiful lips and eyes that even in the mask it looks great. So it wasn't too tough. Any questions?
Entonces, después de cada clip, vamos a abrir a preguntas de la audiencia. Entonces, tenemos unos micrófonos. Si alguien tiene un pregunta acerca del clip que acabamos de ver. Anyone? Got a question? Okay. Well, I'll ask a question. So, you mentioned that the many times the role of cinematographer is to kind of give some ideas to the director.
Well, it depends on the nature of the director. Many directors, the directors I prefer to work with, are the ones who are more concerned with the screenplay and with the character. And then other times you find yourself working with directors who don't have much idea at all. They somehow got themselves into the movie, and then they really don't know how to make it. And then, one way or the other, you take over at least the staging movie. And the lighting, of course. The thing is, many directors have only made one or two films, and by then, by Batman, I'd made 10 or 12. Now I've made over 30. So I have an experience of staging, of how the camera can move, should move, where we can cover, where we don't need to cover, if you understand that, the close-ups, the reverses, all these kinds of things. And I and any good cinematographer will bring that to the table. We have an enormous experience, because we can go from film to film, but the directors often they have a period of 1, 2, 5, or 10 years between films. So at first, they could be very green.
Okay. Let's go to the next clip.
Let's go to the next clip, yeah.
Okay, luces, por favor. Y corre el siguiente clip, por favor.
Affects how much you sleep, how deep, and how you sleep.
Straight ahead.
We can guess.
No, thank you.
Blood disorders and tissue deficiencies result in rapid degeneration similar to the symptoms of accelerated aging. Or we've even had results in monkeys and speeding up the puck. But we are a long way from turning it back. We can't quite promise you that that's love.
You can see the lighting bears perhaps some resemblance to Batman's my obsession with blue light. I, either through sheer ignorance or foolish courage, I never seem to use any film light. You know, that's when you put additional light in to bring out the shadows. I really didn't know how to do that, and so I didn't, and it was effective. We used enormous lights on, that was a real house in Mayfair in London, it wasn't a stage. And so we were using enormous lights that are no longer available, I'm afraid, on big cranes, just to bring soft light in from a distance on the other side of the street, and I just leave it alone. And often that's the best. When you get into trouble with light is when you get too complicated. It was a great cinematographer called Sven Nykvist, who was Ingmar Bergman's cinematographer, and he said it took him his entire career, that wasn't true, but it took part of his career, to learn how to be simple, to have simple staging and a simple lighting plan. If you can do that, and if you have the courage to allow the audience to infer what's happening, even though it's in the deepest shadow, you can get the most beautiful and meaningful results. One good thing to do if you want to learn how to do this, if any of you are studying this, is to look at Blu-rays frame by frame without the sound, and just go in between the cuts and look at how the lighting can be in continuity or how it can be cheated. We learn that light is a powerful creator of the image. Of course, you work with production designers and with, as in The Hunger Genius, with Elena Kananero, with costume. But light is our language, and camera movement is part of our language as well.
And you mentioned that the lighting that you used in this film is no longer available?
Well, the actual lamps, I used old-fashioned arc lights, which burn carbon rods, and they gave a very specific and beautiful light. They were extremely powerful, and the light could be a long way away. And there's something about those lamps that's never been reproduced. All of us who use them would love to have a modern equipment. It hasn't been made yet. We look forward to it.
Amazing that doesn't exist anymore. No. Now, you mentioned to me that you don't consider yourself a technical person. You sit here.
No, I'm not interested in that.
I'm not interested in that. But you obviously you do possess the technical knowledge, obviously, to interact with your colleagues.
To an extent, but I don't think since I stopped shooting 16mm documentaries. I've never loaded a 35mm camera. I wouldn't know how to, although I've worked on 35mm, large-scale movies. I'm really, that's not my focus. I'm far more interested, to the point of obsession, with the script and the images that come from the script, and then how to translate those images onto a screen, and how to persuade. There's also, cinematographers should be able to sell an idea, an image, to the director, to the producers, and to make it seem that it's important enough that they'll spend the money to do it. But you've got to have a strong idea, a visual idea. That's the most powerful thing that's going to drive a movie forward.
Very good. Tenemos una pregunta para Steven aquí en el centro. César, ¿le puedo dar un micrófono al chavo aquí? Ahí, hasta atrás.
César.
So shooting with that deep, rich contrast in this film, specifically it being shot on film, it makes for a very bold choice. And having Bowie's reaction or that moment where Bowie's like completely in shadows is very striking. And I can see a director even just kind of flipping out, like, we gotta see his face, what if we don't see his reaction or whatever. But I was wondering if you could talk about how now with digital, where you can push the image, what the differences are in terms of your workflow, because I know that you mentioned it allows for more mistakes, but I was wondering if there are some benefits to that, or what are the pros and cons of maybe shooting with this very high contrast in film versus shooting it on digital now?
I could, if it were my choice, make that look on a good Alexa, a good digital camera. It's entirely my choice, the contrast and the color, and it's completely possible with digital. The difference specifically in when you're shooting is that the director and all the producers can see what you're doing then and there, and they can start interfering immediately rather than when the scene's already completed. And the great advantage of film is that when you're shooting it in a brave way like that, there's not much they can do to change it after the fact. Whilst I'm afraid digital is so flexible, it gives other people, perhaps people without talent, to destroy the images after the fact. Digital can make images equal or far better than film. It can also enable those who should not be involved to interfere and to break the look.
Right. And my second part to that question is, having chosen such a bold lighting choice, where do you find that your choices for lighting scene come from? Do they come from the character? Do you build off the mood first? Or like what inspires you or your lighting for a particular scene?
the script, the character, I mean, on The Hunger, we channeled Helmut Newton. And then once, a few years later, I met Helmut Newton. I told him, he was very complimented, but it was his sort of aesthetic that drove our look, not just me, but wonderful designer Brian, Tony Scott, and we all were on the same page, which was an extreme page. I mean, I wouldn't have lasted on that film if you could have seen David Bowie's face. I mean, the whole point of it was that he was in a shadow of his life. He was in a he was a shadow character, and to go in and out of light is more powerful than to see everything. It's almost a musical metaphor that you've got to feel the image. And I must say that I work in a somewhat improvisational state. I ask for a lot of equipment and then I switch a lot of it off. Tony Scott was so extreme, though, that he invariably would come on the set and ask me to shut down two lights. So I'd always put up two extra lights. And then I'd shut them down, he'd be happy, and it would be perfect. That's also part of your job as a cinematographer.
It's called the gimme, right? Muchas gracias. ¿Puedo preparar para Steven en casa que tomamos una pregunta en español? ¿Quién tiene un traductor acá arriba? Gracias.
Sí.
¿Y bueno, doctor? Bueno, vamos a ver el siguiente clip, por favor, luces.
I've got lots more dark film to show you.
His armies were freezing and starving in the snows of Russia, where his best general had died of a heart attack. And America had entered the war. For the first time, Hitler's dream of a German empire to last 1,000 years was in doubt. While he hired and fired generals, and the winter grew colder, 15 of his officials were ordered from their commands and ministries to meet in a quiet lakeside residence in Wannsee, in Berlin, far from the crisis at the front. In 2 hours, these men changed the world forever. Only one record of what was said and done here survives from the wreckage of what was a 1,000-year night.
This clip is from a film called Conspiracy, which is its subject matter is the production meeting, the conference about the Holocaust, how to actually do it.
The final solution.
Yes, and it actually happens. The film we made was then contributed to the museum outside Berlin. The house still exists, where students and historians can see it, but it was made with absolute rigor to the truth, to, as far as to the actual incidents. And it's the film, perhaps a very, the film I'm very proud of. We made it for a very low budget. I mean, it's the least money I've ever had to make a movie. And we shot the film, including 2 days of reshoots in 23 days in Berlin and in Studio Shepperton. And it presented enormous problems because it, you can't, unless you see the film, but it's like 15, 17 Nazis around a big conference table. It's basically, the film is set in one room. And to get the eyelines, to get the photography, and to get the continuity of all the speeches, we have wonderful actors, we have Kenneth Branagh, Stanley Tucci, Colin Firth, and many other wonderful and British actors. And it was a real puzzle how to get this film shot in time, in the schedule. We used Super 16, and apart from that, that shot of the aircraft going over Wannsee, it was all shot handheld. And it's all shot, two cameras, two lenses, tight and wide, right beside each other, and in continuity, so that we didn't get mixed up with our angles and with the director, Frank Pearson, who's my friend and passed away a couple of years ago. He was wonderful. He left me alone. He dealt with the actors, which was 17, and that was quite enough to do. And the script. And we managed to shoot at least 10 pages a day, and with some beauty to it as well. But I like this film very much, and it's far more possible to shoot a film like this using digital nowadays, because the cameras are so small, lenses can be very small, than it was when we made Non Super 60.
Now, can you speak a little about, you told me that a cinematographer needs to know much more than just operating the camera and the light.
Well, this is a case in point. There's another scene that we'll see in a moment. One of the most challenging things that will come up in the course of shooting a film is the big conversation around the table. And it's where a film can just fall to pieces, because the actual ways of shooting it, the way of getting the editing to work, the cuts, it is tricky. And you can go days behind. You can shoot too much. You cannot get the eyelines right. I don't know if you guys know what I'm talking about when I say eyelines, but it's if one actor is looking left and you cut to another actor, that other actor must look right, and they certainly have a very obscure reason not to. And the camera must be placed in such a way that this continuity in close-up or in geography is maintained. When I started, I was hopeless at this. I would do everything to avoid having to make an opinion, because having come out of still photography, I just hadn't had that kind of training. And having got to a film school where they didn't know what they were talking about, I hadn't learned anything, but there I was. But I learned pretty quickly, because you have to. Now I'm pretty good at it. But any one of you who is going to shoot films must concentrate on this question of continuity and of eyelines. It's vitally important. And there are all sorts of tricks to it, which I could elaborate for hours, but I won't. Any questions?
Vamos a tomar una pregunta. Y tenemos un equipo para Steven. ¿Puedes escucharla? Un mano por aquí. Ahí. Ok, la pregunta.
Hello, Steven. This is a question, a very basic question. I have no clues about technical things in photography. But I'm wondering about the process itself. In the previous clip, two scenes captured my attention. The first one, when the doctor has a blue light in the background, a yellow one in the front, and you're waiting to capture the green part of the lenses. And then the last one, when David Bowie has like just part of the face, how do you do it? I mean, you practice before the actors come in. Do you know if like what you see through the lens is exactly what you imagine? How many times before the final shot is? That's my question.
Well, it's a very good question. When you're shooting, you do have standards. You cast a blonde for Catherine Deneuve and a tall, gangly guy for David Bowie or Kenneth Branagh or Stanley. But these standards don't really do anything except for you just to judge a little bit about the exposure and the look. I have to order the colors or the lights, the greens, the blues, whatever, before the day. They just won't have. I really have to sort of imagine what it's going to be like, and then I can adjust a little bit. It's this business of having in your mind's eye, having a very strong imagination of what the future will be on the set. You can take photographs, you can look at the set, you can read the script, and something is going on. It's a subconscious process. I make very few tests. There's no time for it. Neither do I look through the camera. I used to look through the camera much more. Now I don't look through the camera. I find it distracting. I'm trying to, when I look at these sets and I look at the light, I have a translation going on in my brain about how it will look on film. And I've often said that when I die, of my heart will be engraved Kodak 5254, 5247, 5218, which were my favorite stars. Of course, that isn't as critical now that I've got a calibrated monitor on set. But again, I don't like to be working inside a tent, away from the director, away from my operator, and particularly away from the actors. The actors are looking for two people to affirm their performance, obviously the director, and I make sure it's the director. When they're looking for performance, I make myself invisible. But they're also looking to me for how they look. Did they hit their marks? Was the light right? And there I can help them. I've taught quite a few actors that how you hit your mark without looking down. You see an actor and they're walking towards the camera and they look down. What they're looking for is a little red dot. It's a giveaway. Because as they look down, you know what's going on. And it takes away from the performance. So for example, with Octavia Spencer, who was so nervous on her movie, she won an Oscar. And I taught her that she should do her walk, but count the steps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And at 5, she's on the mark, but she's never looked up. It's so simple. And other things with someone like the Catherine Deneuve or an instinctive actor like David Bowie, they knew where the light was. You barely have to say it to them. Some actors, however, become so inside their parts that they forget they're even acting, they forget they're on the film. And so they can walk into the shadow and disappear from the camera. This is not a good thing. And in the nicest possible way, you've got to help them. I've sometimes placed a small technician under a table just to lightly tap the ankle of the actor to make them know that they're there. Some actors are bemused by directors who don't want any rehearsal. I've worked with a few of those, and it's terrifying because they think that they're making the film more instinctive, more real by not having technique. But in fact, most actors really do want to know where to stand at a certain point, and where to reach the light. And part of my job is to show them those very things, and sometimes to do it with a hand signal, because the director doesn't want them to know.
Very good. Vamos a apagar luces en el siguiente clip.
Anyway, we were sent off to China.
Ooh, absolutely delicious, if I do say so myself.
Julia, when you finish your term, you'll be the chaperone.
I don't think so. The woman who runs absolutely hates me.
Oh, no one could possibly hate you.
That's true, but she does. Were you spies?
No. Yes. You're in the Office of Strategic Services and you are not spies.
I was only a file clerk. But Paul designed all of the secret war rooms for General Malthus.
Well, just imagine exhibits and things.
He did! He single-handedly won the war!
Well, I had to. Someone did. Yeah, it was dragging on. Anyway, so there we were in China, just friends having dinner. And it turned out to be Julia. It turned out to be Julia all along. Julia, you are the butter to my bread and the breath to my life. I love you, darling girl. Have a Valentine's. Dear Charlie, Julia in front of her stove has the same fascination for me as watching a kettle cook in the sink. The oven door opens and shuts so fast, you hardly notice the deft thrust of the spoon as she dips into her casserole and up to her mouth for a taste check like a perfectly timed little beat on the drums. Then, with her bare fingers, she snatches a set of cannelloni out of the pump of boiling water and she cries, "These damn things are as hot as a steam cock!" She said.
So here you see an example of a scene at a dinner table, very important scene. I find the performances delightful. The atmosphere, the feeling that it's Valentine's Day in Paris. It was shot on a stage, and not too difficult in that the conversation at the table is between two protagonists, Stanley Tucci and Meryl Streep, at either end of the table. So your eye line, your look up and down the table was as clear as day. And then there are a few asides from the other dinner guests. It's interesting you look at how it's cut. It's cut so that when you look at Stanley Tucci, it's from Meryl Streep's point of view. It's from Julia Child's point of view. In other words, he's always shot in a medium wide shot. And then on the reverse to her, she's in a sort of a medium close-up. Not too close, because you need to see the heart. But it's also interesting that, I mean, I wanted it that way. You can never tell if you shoot too much that the director and the editor won't change it, but they didn't. And it's effective because you can see the scene is really about Julia Child, about Meryl Streep character, and you can see from her point of view, and it's an evolving way of looking at the material. This business of the size of the shot, the way it might be cut, the angle of the camera, both in the size of the person within the frame, but also in its angle to the person. One of the problems with making this movie, many people knew that Julia Childs was a very tall woman. She was actually 6'3", and Meryl Streep is 5'5". And so Meryl was extremely concerned all the time that the camera was a little lower than her, and she wore big shoes, and sometimes we built walkways on the set so that when she was walking around on the set, she was raised between the shoes and these little raised tracks for her. She was raised about 6 inches from the normal height, and then by lowering the lens, we could emphasize that. But it went to extremes. In Paris, we had to shoot a Mercado market scene in the street, and it was period. It was meant to be about 1949, and the casting people were told that they had to cast about 250 people to fill the market, but not one of them could be taller than 5'4". And then we put and that made all the build-up with Julia Childs more effective. So all those kind of tricks are part of my job as well.
Now, you mentioned about the shot selection and the editing afterwards. How much of that was storyboarded and discussed with the director?
The director, Nora Ephron, who sadly passed away, but Nora was a wonderful comedic writer and had a great feel for performance, but visually she was pretty naive, if not hopeless. And she unfortunately had storyboarded every single frame of the entire movie in her head with a storyboard artist, but long before I was involved. So there were storyboards for every single moment of the movie, which were utterly useless, because they weren't based on real rehearsal, they weren't based on a cinematic idea, they were based on a writer's idea of the frame. And so there was a lot of tension between Nora and I about that. But she calmed down after a few weeks of seeing things, which were being cut every day.
And I guess with a less experienced cinematographer, that could have been a problem, because they would just follow director's instructions page by page.
If I had done that, Nora would not have been happy with the end result, which she was. I mean, she loved this film. It was probably her most successful movie as a piece of cinema. But yes, she was angry with me that I didn't follow her storyboards yet.
Is there a situation where you will follow the storyboard?
There's situations which I made the storyboards myself and with an artist, and then present it to the director for their commentary and go ahead with that. The previous clip with the aircraft with the swastikas on the wings flying over Wannsee, the conference house near Berlin, I storyboarded that whole sequence. And the actual military aircraft always had the swastika below the wings, so you could see it from the ground. And I asked that they put it on top so the camera could see it from above to give. So, yeah, no, I frequently storyboard specific sequences just so that we can get the cut straight between us all, because sometimes it's a question of safety, as you'll see, and sometimes it's a question of taste. I never do this behind the director's back. I ask him if I may do it, the production pays for it, and then the director amends it as he wishes, or she wishes, and then that's distributed throughout the crew so that we all know what we are about to do.
The storyboards, more often than not, come from the cinematographer, or does the director also bring them sometime?
Tony Scott did storyboards for his entire movie. He'd write them very quickly in the morning. It's unusual for the cinematographer to do storyboards. I don't storyboard the movie, I storyboard sequences that present financial or other kinds of difficulties, you know, ways to get around problems.
Right. Una pregunta? Está atrás, allá.
Hi, Steven. I had two questions that are related. First of all, what's your opinion regarding this new ways of cinematographic language, specifically talking about BR, 360 video? What's your what do you think about that? And the second question is, what do you think that are the biggest challenge for future cinematographers or cinematography as a whole with this evolving ways of storytelling? What do you think about it?
Regarding the VR, it's intriguing. I'm at a loss to see how an audience can be an audience. In other words, when we all sit together and watch and laugh or cry together at a movie, there is a synergy between our reactions or how we all feel in an audience, which I don't understand how it will be achieved using VR with the present techniques. I mean, when you've got to wear goggles and earpieces and stuff to experience the virtual reality, I don't think it's, I may be wrong, but I don't think it's possible to experience my fellow audience members, whether it's my dog sitting on my lap, my wife and friends in our living room, or whether it's a great crowd at a movie theater. So I'm intrigued by the visual look, but I'm dismayed at the thought that we won't be able to see things together. We'll become even more separated in our little cubicles, our little goggles, our little houses, and our little lives, because to be with an audience and enjoying a movie is part of the movie experience. And it brings me to the second question, what are the challenges? Well, the challenges are pretty clear, which is how will the cinematographer maintain control? It's always been the struggle between the director and the cinematographer when they don't see eye to eye. And it's sometimes, often of course, the director is far better qualified to say what he or she wants from a movie than the cinematographer. On the other hand, there have been great collaborations between cinematographers and directors. What has changed, as I was saying earlier, in my experience, is that the authorship and the political power of the cinematographer is diminished by the visual effects supervisor. And so who is really responsible for the image? And that's going to be the biggest struggle. If cinematographers are going to maintain authority, then they must maintain their power. Whether you can do that by personality, reputation, previous work, or not, but for a new cinematographer, that's going to be their most difficult challenge. Apart from all the 1,001 other challenges, but politically, that's a difficult question, a difficult task.
Now, something interesting to me is you also, your work isn't done when principal photography ends. You also come in post and you review the material. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, you review the material as you're going along, every night or every morning, whenever. When the film is cut, and I'm not involved in the cut, when the film is cut, then I go nowadays into a digital laboratory, in previous years into a film laboratory, and I work on the color, the brightness, the darkness, the transitions. The great thing about digital, a digital finish is that I can not only work on each individual shot, but I can work on sequences over time. I can introduce or remove diffusion. I can brighten up, darken down, vignette, do all sorts of things. I could work on one film for 1 year if I was given the time. The longest I've ever had was 4 months, and that was a 6.25-hour movie. Generally speaking, I have 2-3 weeks. And I'm lucky that I have that time. Some, if you are new and you can't get a deal with the studio, then you might have two or three days. But it's a film's look now can be transformed in post-production, whilst I'd say the look of a film on film could only be improved, but not transformed.
Do you have some sort of final approval?
No. I must develop a relationship with the director that they see that I'm valuable, that the cinematographer is valuable, that their skills with cutting and music and all these other things are their provenance and the image is mine. However, they don't have to, and I've been screwed on occasion, and it's been very, very upsetting.
Another question?
Sure. And let's see another clip.
This is por favor.
See?
shooting that scene terrified me. Because it wasn't film. It was at the edge of what film could do, at the edge of what I could see. It was very dark. That was the story, so how far you go. I hate it when movies are supposed to be in the dark and you can see everything. But I hate it when movies are so dark that you can't see anything. So I didn't sleep until that night after we shot this during the day. And that happened a lot with shooting on film. And I was very happy with the look of this. The advantage is that there was a big budget and I could ask for 150 flashlights to be made individually for me so that they all had a beautiful soft light and color. And that really helped. But I scared myself on this. But it worked out pretty nicely. And Bette Midler, of course, is superb.
You said this was shot in a hangar?
Yeah, this was shot in a World War II hangar in Van Nuys, Los Angeles, at the airport.
Why did they park realism? What was the choice between that and the soundstage?
Well, actually, this is bigger than most of the available soundstages. There's a full-size aircraft in there, which you see in other parts of the sequence, and a lot of soldiers there, actually real soldiers who were just brought in for a couple of days. We had to stop shooting the sequence for a while because we lost all our extras. They were all sent to the war in Iraq. The next morning, we didn't know that was going to happen.
Can you tell me a little bit about the lighting that we see there, the lights in the background?
Well, I use big, what I was using were big meteorological balloons. You know, the things that they send up to 20, 30,000 feet? You fill them with helium. And so I floated four big ones around this enormous hangar. And then just bounce light from the floor, just to bring the level of shadow up. And then just a few lights scattered around for backlight. And then always an individual light for Bette Midler to give her you put a good shadow underneath the chin, and you put the light at about 45 degrees to her face. And that just diffused, and that just controlled by the chief electrician, so that she always had a good look. And then these individual flashlights basically lit the scene.
And those flashlights, how'd they come about?
Well, I asked for them to be built, and they were all on batteries, and we had an army of prop men to change the batteries.
Why did they need to be built as opposed to just buying a hardware store?
Because the color of a normal flashlight is variable, and it's hard. I needed all those flashlights to be able to last for a day, you know, with two battery changes, and also to have a beautiful, warm, and soft light. You had to build them. You couldn't. There was no such thing in existence.
So you built one, and you said...
We built one. We tested one. We changed it. We built another. We tested it. This would be going on long before we shot the scene.
In pre-production?
No, actually, while we were shooting. So we, you know, the day could be very long. I could have a call for the whole crew at 5 a.m. in the desert, and we'll shoot until sunset. Then we drive 2 hours back to Los Angeles, and then go on the stage with a stand-in for Bette Midler and test the flashlights. So I would work from 5 a.m. or 4 a.m. until 10. Many days. After another, but that's the way it is. If you can't do that, don't do the job.
So you needed 150 of those small flashlights. I mean, was that the original budget, or something that you just asked for?
It wasn't. It was a big budget, prestige film. It wasn't. If I could do it with less now, because an Alexa camera can, or Red has far greater sensitivity in the shadows. So, but I couldn't do it to make it look better unless I did what I've just explained.
That's something that doesn't sound like it was contemplated from the beginning.
No, not by the producer or the director. I was contemplating it. And in the course of production, I persuaded them to my way of thinking.
And you can just add that line item to the production budget?
Yes, when the production is $60-70 million, you can. Not when it's $6 or $7 million.
Okay. But you had that discretion to suggest it, at least.
Yes. And it's not unusual to have that discretion.
It is unusual?
No, it's not.
It's not unusual.
It's usual. Or at least it used to be usual.
Okay. Una pregunta de la audiencia? Aquí enfrente, perdón.
Buenas tardes. Yo quiero preguntarle si esa ha sido la secuencia en la que más trabajo le ha costado, si hay una peor.
¿Cuál ha sido?
Si esta fue la secuencia que más trabajo le ha costado hacer, o si hay una secuencia peor.
Has that been the most difficult sequence you've ever done, or what has been the most difficult sequence you've ever done?
Well, there are different kinds of difficulties. To shoot a scene underwater is difficult. It may not. But this is pretty difficult. This was a scene of extreme darkness and also a scene which had to be extremely beautiful with an actress of a certain age. And you have to be able to deal with it's not vanity. She had to be, she was the heroine of the movie. She had to be seen, if not as a classic beauty, as someone that the soldiers would fall in love with. So there were a lot of practical difficulties involved in that. But every great scene keeps you up at night. Night before you shoot it and after you shoot it. And it's... I always would feel very happy if I could succeed with that. Other scenes could be physical, could be dangerous, could be ones of endurance. And then sometimes you fail. Sometimes you find you just cannot make a man or a woman or certain actors look as they want to look. And you're in danger of being dismissed, of being fired. I've been asked to take over movies on many occasions because the lead actor, male and or female, have been unhappy with how they look. And I've been threatened with dismissal myself. And that's a tough thing.
You mentioned the helium balloons. Is that a common technique?
It's unnecessary now. Now what you get are actual balloons with lights inside them. So you don't have to bounce onto them, and they're very lightweight. You can move them around. But the technique, the idea is similar. Yeah, this is it.
Now this is por favor.
I want you to tell me your name.
Thank you. My name is Jane.
You're real.
Thank you. My real name is Jane. Thank you. Still Jane.
I've got my own father to fit in. Why don't I just give you orders to come in and you tell me what your name is? Alice.
I promise. Thank you. My real name is plain Jane Jones.
I may be rich, but I'm not stupid.
What if she ain't going to love me and she's stupid?
Don't you fuck around with me!
I apologize.
Accepted. All the girls in this hellhole, the pneumatic robots, the coked up baby dolls, and you're not different. But you're all your stage names to call yourself and you're someone else, so you don't put a shame on the show your cunts and assholes to be fucking strangers. I'm trying to have a conversation in it. I've hacked this room.
This is extra.
We met last year.
Wrong girl.
Talk to me!
I am.
Talk to me in real life. I didn't know you'd be here. I know who you are. I love you. I love everything about you that hurts.
Thank you.
crying, Signorina. You feel the same. I know you feel the same.
You can't cry again.
Hold me. Let me hold you.
Whenever that's touch.
Well, come home with me. It's safe. Let me look after you.
I don't need looking after.
Everyone needs looking after.
I'm not your revenge fuck.
I'll pay you.
I don't need your money.
You have more money.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That's not a rule. You're a little chronic outside here?
Occupational hazard.
Have you ever desired a customer?
Yes.
Well, put me up on this video. Do you desire me? Because I'm being pretty fine honest about my feelings for you.
Your feelings?
Whatever.
No, I don't desire you.
Thank you. Thank you sincerely for your honesty. Do you think because you don't love us, or desire us, or even like us, do you think you've won?
It's not a war.
If I ask you to strip right now, would you?
Of course, you want me to.
Oh. Alice, tell me something true.
Wine's the most fun a girl can have without taking her clothes off. But it's better if you do.
You're cold. You're all cold at heart. What did you do to get a bit of intimacy around here?
Maybe next time I'll have worked on my intimacy.
No, I tell you it's no work. So you're going to tell your girl right now. And you're going to turn around very slowly. And you're going to bend over. And you're going to touch the fucking floor for my viewing pleasure.
Is that what you want?
What else could I want?
So it's interesting, I take a little pride in that scene that both those actors were nominated for an Oscar for their performance in Closer. Mike Nichols directed it. And the dance of the camera, where you place the camera, when a scene of passion, of cruelty, and aggression between a man and a woman, where do you put the lens? How should it look? You've got to get it right. You can't be too much. I go crazy when I see a camera in the wrong place in a scene. It's so important that you can see into the soul of the actor, that you see their eyes, and that they are looking very close to the lens. And it involves you. And if the actor makes the performance of their career and the camera is in the wrong spot, you really hurt them. They know that, or they find out. And I'm very interested in the staging. I'm now at a point where I'm far more interested in these questions of staging, of size, of culling, of look, reflecting not my vanity or my ideas or my blue light or pink light or whatever, but very much Patrick Marvel, British playwright, wrote this and then wrote the screenplay that we made. And I'm trying all the time to take my direction as a cinematographer from the material. I think I do this more because I'm a little, just a small bit wiser than I used to be. And also working with somebody like Mike Nichols, who never, ever told me what to do. He usually on a movie would only have one or two sequences or ideas that he insisted we did. And I would ask him why, and sometimes he would say, I don't know. And that was fine for me, because people of great talent, when they work subconsciously, they reach a point where you should really respect that their subconscious is actually speaking to them on the stage, on the studio floor, on the page, and let's just go with that approach.
Now, you mentioned in some instances, in some films, you don't even look to the camera lens. Did you look to the lens when you were doing this sequence?
No, I'm looking at a monitor. But that doesn't give you the look, but it does give you the composition, the angle. So you can look through and then to take the camera a little further left. On the dolly, the camera's on the dolly, you move back and forward, and you have a plate that, say, goes 4 feet or a meter left and right. The camera's in the middle of the plate, and you can push it left, push it left, push it left, push it. Just that, like that, just to bring the lens into a spot where it seems there is a confluence of the angle of the look and of the actor's performance. And sometimes you actually do it in the as the camera's rolling. I've often just crept forward and I've just said to the operator, left, 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 left. It is here, and the dolly grip will just move it over, just. And then with the great camera operators, Steadicam, you can have an earpiece. And then there's something that's driving you crazy that he's not got there. He can just slowly slide the lens into what you think is a better position.
Was there a lot of rehearsal for a scene like this?
There was, with Mike Nichols, there was always a significant rehearsal. Before we started shooting, and then on this we rehearsed for about 2 or 3 hours before we began shooting the next morning.
And I assume there's a rehearsal with just the actors, and then there's a rehearsal maybe with just the cameraman, and then maybe there's a rehearsal with...
No. There's a read-through, mm-hmm. which is close to the actors, the director, the script supervisor, and I was privileged to be included, so I could see how this all went down. Then would be a rehearsal, basically, just with the actors and the director, into which I would be invited with the script supervisor. Then we'd make our shooting plan, talk about how we would cover the whole scene with the director, with Mike Nichols. And I'd write this down, or we'd make notes. Not only the angles, but the order in which the shots should be shot. But this is done in the moment, on the day, within the hour of shooting. Then the actors would go away and prepare, make up hair, whatever. And then there would be, and then the crew would come in and we would light and be ready to shoot.
The scene was shot one day?
Two days. But it's much longer than what you just see.
Una pregunta. ¿Qué hay uno enfrente?
Claro.
Sí, primero que nada, muchas gracias por venir y hablar con nosotros. Bueno, tengo dos preguntas. La primera es, usted mencionó hace un momento que había un lugar correcto para la cámara de cada escena. ¿Eso se consigue por conocimiento técnico o es algo un poco más interno? No sé cómo decirlo. Y la segunda, leyendo en internet y demás, encontré que muchas veces al principio de la carrera de un cineasta que tiene que trabajar gratis para ir consiguiendo experiencia y demás. Quería saber si usted tenía algún consejo, algún tip para no necesariamente tener que trabajar gratis, porque hay muchos aquí que les gustaría entrar en ese mundo y sin dinero simplemente no se puede. Eso sí.
Thank you. The question of where's the right spot for the camera is entirely instinctive on my part, but of course it's informed over the years by my mistakes, or the mistakes of others. I mean, I watch a lot of film, people I admire, and also I watch films where I don't admire it, and I'm trying to see why it worked, and more importantly, why it doesn't work. There are technical rules to be broken, of course, but it's good if you're working on an art form to have a basic technique. I'm not talking about anything very complicated, but to be interested in how the masters have worked in the past, to look at the films that you admire, to look, for example, at 12 Angry Men, a movie shot entirely in the jury room, and to see how the camera was placed and how everything worked. I've looked at these things over and over and over again. I think I've absorbed them. So nowadays, my right place is where I feel better, but like being able to translate film into your vision, camera placement, you can also feel instinctively. As to working for free, I had to do it, but I had my still photography as a means to earn some money. But many people work for free because they've also had side jobs or side things, or you can have rich parents, a rich wife or husband, boyfriend, girlfriend, anything, so you can get that experience. You've got to be ruthlessly ambitious, because you can't go, you can't do it unless you have that spur. You can't be too modest and you can't be too soft-spoken. And I had to work free. I've risked my life many times, on documentaries especially, on helicopter shoots, because I said, fuck it, I've got to do this thing, and if I'm killed, well, that's too bad, but if I'm not killed, that's great. And so far, so good. But that question of working free is, if that really worries you, you're not going to be able to do the job. And you've got to be able to, I sold all my cameras. I had no means of income, because I knew that when I was really hard up and I couldn't pay the rent, I didn't want to be able to fall back on what I knew, on how I used to earn. I had to be ambitious to a fault. And I apologize. It's a cruel way of life, and at first in particular, and it's there's literally almost no mercy. And it affects you, as a person, but I'm sure it hasn't changed. If you're all starting, have courage.
Thank you, Paul. Can I say
something?
Hey, fuck! I want to go to London. I want to go to Vietnam. I want to show unity to the fellas up here. The league, the top, in the dark. We got to show ass. Because the president, we got to bring the super heavy punk to the capital. There's a 22 piece. Government, army, army, tag on the right, 6 pounds.
I saw these executives coming in.
Can't extend it.
What?
Can't extend
it. You have to see it.
Right now. then his family moved to the Tacoma. And that's when we met.
It's not good, it's bad.
That's not the good news, bro.
That was shot on digital. Everything else you've seen and you'll see film. It's extremely interesting to work that sequence out because there was no money for it. I involved myself deeply because it could be really hokey. And I actually found the aircraft. There was a museum in I think it's Houston, and I flew there to look at it. And I got chatting with the pilots, and it was a Vietnam-era troop transport made in Canada, and it still had the bullet holes in it from these kind of missions. And they'd be ex-Vietnam pilots and thought being able to fly this thing, and someone paid for it and have fun, and then asked them to do a dangerous landing, you know, a stunt landing. They loved the idea. They also showed me video of the engine catching on fire. That wasn't deliberate, but it happened quite often. And we worked a deal out of them. It was an enormous aircraft, and you couldn't get it in on stage. You couldn't even get it in a hangar at an airfield. It was outside. And we couldn't possibly fly it and shoot. So we had to work out a method by which we could make it look as if they're in the air, and get the feeling of them being under attack, and it's terrified, and the camera moving and everything. And I was able to use a normal Alexa camera and just suspend it on that sort of wire that goes down the fuselage. But also I was able to use a tiny Canon camera, a small Canon C500 with a wide lens. We took the radios out of the equipment bay by the pilot and put a very wide lens there so that we could be in an impossible position to see the pilot and to see James Brown. And then we used green screen out of the back. They always literally flew with the back, so it was so hot in Vietnam, and so we could put green screen there. And I shot all the plates, you know, over the jungle, which was in Mississippi. And I shot all of those from a helicopter. And it was, sometimes you can have too much money and you become less inventive. But this one we had too little, and it worked out better.
Una pregunta rápida, acá atrás.
Hola, sé que esta es una masterclass, pero me gustaría que nos compartiera su opinión en torno al trabajo de Manuel Lubensky y también que nos compartiera en qué está trabajando.
Do you have an opinion over Manuel Lubensky, by any chance?
Well, sure, he's my friend. I love him. He's a genius and a Mexican. So he's a wonderful guy, wonderful cinematographer. All good fortune to him, and I applaud him, of course. He owes me $15 from. we were one time nominated for the Academy Award. He didn't understand that when you go to the bar behind the Oscar auditorium, you have to pay for your drinks. So when free, so I bought him a drink. He's great.
We have quite a few clips to get through. So
okay, next one.
Listen for her.
We're running out of time. I have a few more clips to show you. I'll be brief. This is all real. No visual effects in it whatsoever. That house was recreated from a house that exists in Hollywood Hills at another location. And it cost $1 million to build. And it was detonated from a space shuttle explosive that gets rid of the fuel tanks on the space shuttle. It took 7 seconds to come down. We used 13 cameras with 4 backups, and we orchestrated, we choreographed 5 or 6 simultaneous pieces of action around the explosion, around the car. Mel Gibson, Danny Glover, Joe Pesci, plus the stunt guys are real people in the house. Who dumped all their lives, quite literally, did it. the technology was not available to do it as a model. There was no technology that could be as real as this. And it took 3 weeks to light and prepare all the cameras. And the extraordinary thing is that I spoke with the technician who, I said, where will the house end when it comes down the mountain? I mean, where do you think it will be? And he just simply said, it's gonna end there. So I placed three cameras, different lenses and speeds, in big metal housings in case he was wrong. But he wasn't wrong. It ended right there. Exactly. Incredible technician. And it worked out fine, that thing, or it would never have worked again. And little tricks, all the lights in the house were on wheels. So when the explosion happened and the house is coming down the hillside, all the lights stay out in the windows. And so every light was on a roll and they stayed on, things like that. And it was quite a big night. Yeah. Let's go on to the next clip.
Lucas?
Go right back to the beginning when the car pulls up. All right, so what's happening here looks very simple. She gets out of the car, she goes into the house. It's the first time an audience sees the house, and we see where she lives. And as she goes up the stairs, the camera rises with her and does a circular motion, all 360 degrees, in the stairwell of a real house. This is not a difficult shot to do on... This is not a difficult shot to do on stage, but in a real house where you can't get a crane in and so on and so forth. We used a rock and roll pedestal that you place in concerts, which just goes up and down. And then we put the pedestal on a camera dolly that could go around the floor. And then we used an anti-vibration head on the top of the pedestal that would get rid of any shake and could do 360 degrees as Emma Stone went up the stairs. So what looks very simple actually took a lot of thought and a lot of planning. But it's effective because it's an introduction into her world. So look for that shot and you'll see what I mean.
Entonces regresamos tantito, bajamos luces y dejamos correr la escena que ella sube los escalones. Gracias.
Good, back to the beginning.
Al principio, por favor.
¡Mamá!
Al principio, por favor.
Mama! Mama? Is this a little too young? Hessa loves you everything.
Oh, hell, you're right.
Okay, so that's a little masterclass trick. The only way you can get away with that is to having a fantastic crew. You need a dolly grip, you need a key grip, you need all the engineering expertise. And it wasn't a high budget film, it wasn't expensive to do this, but you need a crew who can improvise and can work remotely and do this sort of thing. They had we arranged that this was the first shot we did in this location. So they had the previous day in pre-production to get it ready. So I'm very happy with it.
This is a real house?
Yes. Yes.
And you obviously scouted a house and you came up with this idea once you saw the house, or was this...
No, once I saw the house, okay. I came up with the idea.
And it's compared to Lethal Weapon 2 or any number of the films, this is a relatively small budget, correct?
Yes, this is 25 million.
Okay. But not small by indie standards. But the pedestal that they created, that sounds like a very elaborate and expensive...
No, there's hundreds of them in existence, mm-hmm. because they use them in rock and roll concerts. If you have an auditorium like this much larger, you know, with thousands of people, you can't move the camera except from overhead. So these things can just go up and down, but they can't move. So we put the up and down thing on the round and round thing with the camera thing that went around with the other thing that's vibrating.
Okay, on the thing. Next clip.
Yeah.
Luces, por favor.
Yeah.
great experience with Francis Ford Coppola. Unbelievable adventure. We truly, I still don't know how to survive it. Politically, I had more people trying to get rid of me than you can imagine. On the first day of shooting, they sent a car to pick me up at my apartment in New York to take me to the set. At the end of the day, there was no car to take me home because they didn't think I'd survive beyond lunchtime. And so I knew that I had enemies everywhere. And they were serious business until Francis fired them all. And then we all got along much better. It's part of the melodrama of making movies, especially movies that is being financed out of Atlantic City in Las Vegas. It was the only movie I've been on, I think, in which one of the producers was murdered. And that's before we started shooting. Let's see the last clip. It is the last clip.
Yeah, I believe so. Before we jump to that, can you go into more detail a little bit about what created that? What would they have preferred, if not you? What would they have rather had?
There was another director.
Okay.
But he lost his nerve. Mm-hmm. And he'd already hired another cameraman. But when he stepped aside, Francis didn't want to use that crew. And he'd seen The Hunger, which we saw at the beginning with David Bowie and Catherine Deneuve. And I was shooting a commercial in New York, and he called. And I thought it was somebody on the crew having a joke. And I went and saw him, and we got on great.
Bueno, luces, el siguiente clip.
Voz con Todos, un espacio para la producción independiente, las buenas ideas y los creadores de nuestro país. Contenidos con un valor social y cultural único, para audiencias diversas y plurales. El Sistema Público de Radiodifusión apoya a la industria cinematográfica y está presente en el Festival Internacional de Cine de Guanajuato.